Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. This is Saint Tyrone from the 404 coming live and direct to you. Let's see if I can adjust this 1 second. Yeah, there we go. We got it fixed now. Coming live and direct to you. Live and direct to you. This is part two and of a phenomenal, I would consider, lifelong future study for me. This is something you can't study in one day. This is thousands of years of history, some of it hidden and some of it is real. And now that we live in a time where we have the access to Google and the viral supercomputers that allow us to have things such as YouTube, it is just a tremendous opportunity of opportunities to be able to have things of this nature. So I want to first and foremost talk about Google / YouTube. They're all one and the same. And the YouTube, or the free booty, stop. I'm talking. Stop. My dog's barking. Hey. Sorry, I have to tell my dogs to be quiet, as we're doing a very important live stream. I want to make sure we document this the right way. First and foremost, what I want to do is, I'm Hank Tyrone from the 404 coming live and direct. And I want to definitely say that, as the screen says, this is a title, Khazaria, Talmud, Judaism, Russia, and the book, Facts Are Facts, by Benjamin H. Freeman. I also have a new book that I'm going to show you tonight, and I'll give it to you soon, as a phenomenal, phenomenal book. But first and foremost, as I have my beautiful background music, make sure it's not too loud. Let me turn it down just a little bit. It's about 40 decibels, negative 40 decibels. There we go, negative 40. And I want to show you the amazing thing of YouTube Premium. For those that may not be officially YouTubers, obviously I would think you are if you are on this video, but you may be brand new to my channel, you may be brand new to YouTube and may not know about some of the benefits of the $29, probably be $30 a month fee we pay, and the benefits of it. Well, one of the major benefits is there's the YouTube algorithm. And the YouTube algorithm, based on what you click on, at the very top, it basically summarizes the types of videos that you like in these little black boxes. For example, mixes, music, lives, healing prayers, meditation flights, contemporary worship music, dog walking, wildlife. These are the things that I watch the most. I have two dogs that love to watch dogs. And so in my house, I let my videos for music for dogs play and throughout my work. And my dogs love it. They don't tear up my home, and they sleep, and they love seeing other dogs on the big 60-inch TV screen. And they bark at it, and they have a great time. At the same time, I have other videos that I've watched. And the amazing thing about what YouTube is doing is the people. Because what people can do is their VHS cassettes, their DVDs, their old tapes that go back to the 1950s are being found. For example, Oral Roberts is a minister that I studied under when I was an Oklahoma Seminary student at Rhema Bible Training Center. And I went to a place called the Healing Center, or they call it at Oral Roberts University, the Holy Spirit Research Center. The Holy Spirit Research Center. And I would watch these on VHS cassettes in 2001, 2, 3, and 4 of crusades that happened in the 50s. And of course, these are majority Europeans. We're talking right after World War II, right? And at the big 1950s were, of course, America's boom, but at the same time, it was America's financial boom because the war had killed everybody else around the world. It was also a religious boom. People like T.L. Osborne, the Voices of Healing, A. Allen, many great men of God came out and had these tent revivals. And so to be able to watch these, knowing that tomorrow will not be like this because our technology is going to be farther advanced, but it's going to be very similar. God is going to move again, and His Spirit is going to move and touch people's lives. So I definitely want to make sure I start off and say, before we even start in this video that I'm a born-again believer that believes in the power of God, that I have a background that is multifaceted from many different ministries, and I will be walking through them as I talk about this powerful subject right now, because I believe it's a very important subject for the last days, and that we as Christians need to know exactly what's going on. As the Bible says, we need to be wise as serpents, but harmless as doves, But the key part is be wise, because we're going to be harmless. Why? Because we have the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit always wants to guide us and to walk in peaceably. We studied the New Testament. We know how many of the epistles taught us about be slow to speak, slow to get anger, slow to wrath. And that it was always about being slow, not hasty, not jumping on stuff, not just letting your emotions go berserk, even sometimes when you want to. Hallelujah. I've been in that moment many times recently. But the topic of this is to talk specifically about the premium. And if you don't use YouTube Premium, I encourage you to. It will probably take you about 2 to 3 years of the algorithm. That's a program that Google creates behind the scenes that basically selects the videos that you normally click on, but it also adjusts to what we call whatever is hot, and people will send videos to you, and this is the main screen. We call this the home screen. So if you look at the home screen, you'll see, of course, there's what we call shorts. Then after that, you have different videos that I've watched, movies that I've watched. Then they try to recommend different movies for you based upon what you've watched. And then videos you've watched, TV things that you watch, as you can see, my mindset, my watches, my watch hours, that's the word, will be considered ministry, and then, of course, political science related, as well as biblical Christianity ministry related. So these are things that I watch. Now, here's the thing with this is there's tons of other stuff that I don't watch. So there's a lot of stuff out here that's on YouTube that I totally disagree with. Avoid like the plague, and I tell you to do the same thing. But again, as parents, that's why we got to make sure our kids are not just going on YouTube and clicking on stuff. Because the same way growing up, you can go on message boards and click on stuff. You can go on YouTube and click on things and hear all kinds of lies and not truths and get people caught up in horrific, horrific ways. But I want to talk to you specifically as I go into, I call it the Encyclopedia, Encyclopedia Britannica, but I will call it the new Encyclopedia YouTube. I want to talk to you about Benjamin H. Friedman. Just to see what the Encyclopedia YouTube pulls up as it pulls up. Now, this is a video that came out by a so-called guy named Benjamin H. Friedman. And there's so many different Benjamins. Just like there's so many different, my name is Hank. There's so many different Hanks. So this is probably, you have to do a deep dive, and then you have to be more specific, Hank. And I would say in the title of this is book, Facts Are Facts. And you'll notice there may be one little book that comes out and had 230 views. 230 views. Well, I've created a video already and it hasn't obviously shown up yet, and I need to go and look at it. But if you look close to the right, there's a program called TubeBuddy. And what TubeBuddy does is that you can buy this extra add-on to add to YouTube Premium, where it pulls out what's called the common video tags, the common key search words that the algorithm uses to organize all of these people's uploaded videos. Because just as quickly as I can click this button right here and hit upload video, go live, or create a post, you can. So just imagine, that means that trillions of videos, right? Billions of people on the planet, there'll be trillions of videos on YouTube. And all of them have to be organized. And you got to be able to figure out where to find things and what's true and what's not true, right? So Facts Are Facts. This person who did this a month ago, and it's so surreal that this is not a month ago, and I did a video just about a few days ago that I'll show you in a minute that is phenomenal. And we're going to do a new video right now where we're going to go to Amazon Kindle, and we're going to take the book that I purchased off Amazon Kindle and read it and show it on the screen and let you be able to stop, pause, read for yourself with beautiful background music, with and also in the presence of God, and I believe it's angels and ministering spirits to help guide us in this. So first off, this is 1 minute and 39 seconds. So unfortunately, the person that did this only wanted to do 1 minute and 39 seconds, so you don't get that much. But I don't think there's going to be a copyright, so I'm going to print this and let you see what the video says. Here we go. The most important conversation. I think that the guy did a, I'm not sure there's a something with my computer that whenever bass tries to go through this, the computer system, there's clipping. I don't know why there's clipping, but there's something going on with the guys. Either the guy's sound card was too loud when he made his video, and I hope that we don't hear a lot of clipping or any clipping as we do this live stream through StreamYard's server way out in California, and I'm in Georgia. But this service that I pay $50 a month, which is amazing, allows me to do this. And it's much better than the old-fashioned ways of buying software and having to use their software and then buying software for $100 and then doing the videos and uploading to YouTube. And then, oh, man, you save hours using StreamYard than having to go through the actual ways that we've done it before. What I want to do now is I want to take you to history. And I want to take you to an episode of a video from a person of the Ottoman Empire. And the title of this video is called Hidden Khazar History. Okay? There's going to be some music, so I'm going to turn my music down so I don't get no extra music. And as soon as it catches up, we'll be able to play this video. Here we go. Not sure where this is from. I'm looking for the original person and whoever this person from the Middle East is, but I do believe that what he is about to say is very unique and very true, and millions of American people and people around the world don't know.
Shortly after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, something very mysterious happened in that part of the world that historians have chosen to bury. A tribe called the Khazar, chose to embrace Judaism and so the world witnessed for the first time the very strange phenomenon of a non-Semitic people becoming Jews. Non-Semitic becoming Jews. The genetic research is available on the internet. Anyone can study it. You have conferences, medical conferences, which were organized to study these people, their genetic composition. They had a genetic composition which was unique in all of mankind. No people in the world were like them. This is scientific research. And these people, the Khazar, chose to convert to Judaism, but they did so not for any religious reasons. They were not so much interested in the Kitab and to follow the law. They embraced Judaism for purposes of political expediency. They were sandwiched between Islam and Christianity, Byzantine Christianity, and they chose Judaism. These European Jews, who have no racial, biological connection with the Banu Israel, multiplied and multiplied and breed it to such an extent that today nine in every 10 Jews in the world, 90% or more, are European Jews. They outnumber the Semitic Jews.
So right there, as you look closely, what they did was they just edited in a person that supposedly is of darker hue, that is not what we consider of European or non-melanated genetic origin, that is north of Caucasus Mountains. And what he says, that the individuals that today are considered the Jews, the ones that went to Palestine in 1948 due to a lie called the Balfour Declaration with England as payment for getting America to World War II and costing the lives of thousands or millions of soldiers that paid that price for the world in World War II, not knowing that all of this was a game, it was a play, it was a goal for the group. This tiny, tiny group of people known as, we will call them today, Yiddish German Jews, a.k.a. Khazarian so-called Jews. The point we want to state first and foremost, before I show you the great book, is that just like anyone today can convert to Christianity the moment they decide to pray the prayer, you can convert to Judaism. You can convert to Catholicism. You can convert to any monotheistic faith. Amen. Islam, it doesn't matter. All you have to do is state it. The problem is making sure that who you do convert to, you have done your research to find out if it's the right God. Because there are penalties and curses that will be put on you if you serve the wrong God. So I would say to those that are religious to go and study, first off, the oldest books of the Bible, Torah. Study the Torah. Study the God of the Hebrew Israelites. Study the commandments of the first five books of the Bible. Then go study Islam. Study their what we call their holy books. Then study the Talmud and study their holy books. And then do a deep dive to find out what and why and what are they, why they're different, and then determine based upon that, your decision. So, what I want to do is I want to show you, as he says, this last part, this is phenomenal.
9-1 or 10-1. These European Jews, if you look at the list of names of Nobel Prizes for science, for literature, would you name it? You will find that these are people who far exceed the rest of mankind in their intellectual brilliance, in their academic achievements, in their scientific research. They are
This next part is phenomenal. He's about to talk about the war. And for those who don't know, we're going to find out about this in the book Facts or Facts in a second. I've done a video already on this that I think is phenomenal, and I'll encourage you to watch. As well as you will find out about this on your own research, as the Lord would direct you. Because not I, but many people are making videos and talking about these complex topics.
People are different from the rest of mankind. And then you find that these Chazar who became Jews also chose to become Christians. So you have the Chazar infiltrating the camp of Judaism and infiltrated in the camp of Christianity as well. And from that,
we get in America what we call the Christian Israeli Alliance. We get the Jerry Falwell deciding that all Christians should support Israel. The argument that Billy Graham and many people of my particular denomination would stand and say that the true Jews are these Khazars that studied Talmud Judaism that lived in Russia, Poland, Czechoslovakia, all of the northern parts. They never lived in Africa. They never were in Egypt. They never were connected to the Torah. But just like there are millions and millions of Christians that are engrafted in the vine of Christianity, Byzantine Christianity, or Roman Christianity, or now in America, Protestant Christianity. The same thing applies here. What he said earlier at the beginning, and he might say in a minute, is that they joined Judaism for no apparent reason other than it was profitable. That they had three different religions that they could have chose from in 780 AD. And the Khazarian king decided to pick one, and that was Judaism, due to the fact that there were wars, and the one that was the smallest and the weakest was Judaism. Because what ended up happening is God said in Deuteronomy 28 that he was going to put a curse on his people because they disobeyed him, and so there was a vacuum, and that vacuum allowed a certain group of people, the Khazars, to basically overtake and infiltrate that missing vacuum, because the slaves, aka the Hebrew Israelites, were basically being put into slavery all around the world, because Deuteronomy verse 28 verses Deuteronomy verses 28 verse chapter 28 verses 16-68 says so many curses that I did a video on it earlier today about this. Let's let him finish.
The ranks of these Khazar Jews and Khazar Christians, the emergence of the Jewish Christian Alliance, can be traced.
Yes, it can. But this all started early when they first came to America in 1895. This started when they first came to America and set up World War I and set up World War II. And it's setting up the Federal Reserve, and it's setting up the system of American government. And for many parts of America, if you look at most of the American corporations, they're run by these Khazars. And they are one, and they are very powerful. They've got Khazarian schools, they've got Khazarian, what we call Hasidic, Khazarian, Jewish schools, synagogues, Talmuds. And the argument, of course, is that the moment you call them out, they attack you, and because the love of God is in them, it's the hate of the devil that's in them. And so in order to fight back, they come at you in ways that is tremendous to take you out. The problem, of course, with that is that Yah, I know, is very displeased with seeing the people that say they represent him act this way, which makes you question, are these people representing the true living and holy God? And that's something you got to study out and find out for yourself. And that's what I'm doing, and that's why I'm making these videos.
It is this Jewish Christian alliance, Chazal, which eventually gives birth to the Zionist movement.
Yes.
The Zionist movement has absolutely nothing to do with Banu Israel.
No, it does not.
It is an essentially and an exclusively European achievement.
Yes, it is. Listen to this.
Chazar, who having become Jews, first
in 780 AD,
who built an empire.
Yes, 780 AD.
Was the most powerful.
They were actually built before 780 AD. They were a group of pagans that lived in the area right above, and we'll talk about this in a moment. I'll show you a screenshot of where this was. And they were serving as, you know, any other so-called pagans would be. You know, gods of wood and stone, the Lord God would call, would say they were. They were serving a phallic religion, the penis. And so homosexuality was really a part of their faith. At the same time, they had heterosexual relationships too. That's how they were able to multiply, right? So they were, in essence, bisexuals, if that makes sense. But they did not serve a God that was a we would consider of a monotheistic faith. And so when they chose Judaism, what they did was they took all of the pharaohs and all the pharaohs that came out of the slavery of the Talmud, which is Iran, the Persians, which had our people captured, mixed together and created what's called an oral law, and we call it the Talmud. And because of the Talmud, it usurps anything that happened 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 years ago when God had Moses write his wonderful five books. And then, of course, the histories of the minor prophets and the major prophets, as well as the book of Psalms, Job, Jasher, many of the Old Testament books. And then, of course, from there get the Maccabees and the books missing between Malachi and Matthew, and then the Gospels and the Pauline epistles, and then Revelation. And then from there, we kind of say, okay, that stops. No, there's nothing new. The rest of the world just exists off of all of that. And people are studying right now trying to see if there are any other books that are missing that we haven't been told about. And I think they are. But he's going to say something right now that blows me away at minute 28. And so right now I need to make sure I forgot. I got to put my timestamps in so I don't have to do this a second time. I can just put the timestamps in right when I'm finished. So the first 28 minutes, we can consider this to be the opening. And then we'll get right into doing the actual sections, and hopefully we get through this within 1 hour. I like to be no more than 1 hour on these blogs in Jesus' name. So at 28 minutes, we can say, all right, so now let's keep going and let's let him finish. It's only about,
look, in Europe and Central Asia. And when the armies of Islam had simultaneously defeated the two superpowers in the world, the Persian Empire and Byzantium, and had emerged...
Notice he doesn't say the Christian Empire. He says Byzantium. But Byzantium meant the Christian, the Rome, the Eastern Orthodox Catholic or Christian Church. And so by studying history, you understand Turkey was where it was at, Constantinople, a.k.a. Turkey. And then it moved from there to Italy, where it's at Rome today. So the Ottoman, of course, as he says, the Ottoman empires came in, and they came, they of course, you see, he says, they destroyed two armies, the Persians, a.k.a. in Iraq and Iran, and then, of course, the so-called Christians in Italy or Roman or Vatican, but they couldn't destroy this group that was right north of Armenia called the Khazarians. But what happened? Who did destroy them? The Rus, the Russians from the north did. And they destroyed them, and to this day, that name, Khazaria, has been hidden to the point that now, years later, someone pulls out this word that when you look on a map, you will never see Khazaria. But you will see a Kazakhstan. But Kazakh versus Khazar, they sound close, but they're not exactly the same.
The most powerful military force in the world has blocked our way. We could not defeat them. And so it would be quite correct to say that the Khazar demonstrated a military power without equal in the world at that time. It is from this part of the world that they spread out. They spread out to Eastern Europe. They spread to Russia.
He said they spread out. He couldn't pronounce it correctly. He was saying they spread out to Eastern Europe. He misses a whole lot because, again, he's not a scholar. He's pulling out and jumping hundreds of years and going forward and stuff. But to get really deep in this, what ended up happening, they were overtaken by the Russians. And so before there was the so-called Bolshevik Revolution, Russia was basically nothing, but they were a big, big, big part of the North. And they came in and took them over. And after they were taken over, they got mixed in, but they were very smart and very sophisticated. And so let's go and let's talk about that instead of me just telling you. I'm now going to pull up my wonderful, let's go out of here, my Kindle. And I'm going to show you two books. One is called Facts or Facts here by Benjamin H. Freeman. And then we're going to talk about The Talmud by Michael Rodickson. And then Who is Esau Edom by Charles Weissman. We won't do all these in this one video. These will be separate videos, but I like to kind of lead and talk about them. And thank God for Kindle, because the way I've done in the past is you try to scan the book into a scanner and then show it on a piece on a computer screen. Today we don't have to do that. Thank you, Lord. So in the book Facts of Facts, which I did a great, great video earlier about this, it is a really small book. It can be shrunk into based on how you want to read it. I have it in two different ways, this way or this way. And so this is the cover. And basically, it doesn't have, and you have to buy this, and I would encourage it only costs $7.99 on Kindle, but I would encourage every person to buy this book if you have fascinations about the history of people. And if you're a Bible person, you automatically read the Old Testament and wonder who are the different tribes. When I'm reading the Old Testament and my prayer every day, we're studying 1 Samuel, 2 Samuel, and we're looking at the so-called tribe of Judah, or Judah, as they would be called. J was no such thing as a J. And that is only one tribe out of 12 tribes that God picked. And as he picked these people, he basically told them, many different times to Moses about it, what he expected of them and what he wanted them to follow and what he wanted them to do. Unfortunately, they did not obey. Many, many times they didn't. To the point where he even raised up Saul, a king. And as he raised Saul up as a king, he still couldn't get what God, they still could not obey God the way God wanted them to be, to obey him. And so then what ended up happening, as we know, is that the Lord killed Saul and then raised up David. And of course, David was raised and they called him a man after God's own heart. But he then cheated and sinned and did horrible things as well. And then, of course, he has a son named Solomon, and Solomon becomes the most wisest of all the world. But then what did Solomon do? Solomon then had ended up 1,000 different vaginas that he had sex with, and ended up writing Ecclesiastes saying that life is basically vanity, that it's nothing. And basically, in essence, he turned his back on what God said to his grandfather's grandfather's grandfather. And so it always seems like every subgeneration after, it gets worse than the previous. And when we look at life today, it's kind of very similar. When we see people that their father was a pastor, the children don't become one. They become worse, and the grandchildren worse, and the great-grandchildren worse. And because they don't really study and meet the Lord for themselves. And so like every generation has to meet God for themselves. And not live off the belief of their father or their mother or their cousins or uncles or whatever. And so for me, it's kind of, that's how my life has been. Because when I came to Christ age 21 for myself. And my mother was not a devout Christian. Maybe that's why she died at an early age. I do believe the scriptures that says that, you know, God will give you long life if you obey his commandments. That's one of the benefits of obeying him. But as I study the Old Testament, I see disobedience can equal death, premature death, might I add. So for me, this is a very serious thing to be talking about right now, because you're about to hear, about to see, break down some powerful points. So as I open this up and I expand this, and you won't be able to see everything, but I'm going to see if I could press the button. And let's see if I can zoom in. We're looking at one page at a time, so there'll be lots and lots of pages. But I think it's much better to do one page at a time and then to zoom using the font size trick here. Yeah, I like that. And I think now you can see who the person, this guy who wrote this. This was a man, literally, who decided to go from being a Ashkenaz to a Catholic. And, of course, the question is which one's better, which one's worse. The bottom line is that Catholics, which they are very great people, don't study God's word either. And then, of course, those that are so-called Jewish, they study multiple words that are not of God. The Encyclopedia Judaica, basically the Talmud. There's many other literature books on their religion that don't even, that were never written by God, saints, and they are supposedly written by the so-called Pharisees, that in an oral way that God gave them a new revelation that he did not give Moses, which then it blows you away, because some of the things that you read in the Talmud are heinous. But unfortunately, they are enacted in many of our laws and our rules in legal world today. So the reality is that what I'm saying to you is that the more you study this, the more you'll understand why we act the way we act, why the laws are created the way they're created, and you will understand the world in ways that you never understood the world before. Because most of us kind of been in our little Christian bubble, going to church on Sunday or Wednesday or both, and then living our life, and that's it. Well, there's a lot more to Christianity than just that. So, as you see the opening of the book, now we'll go into the next page. As you can see, it was written by him in Boston, Mass. And he came out of New York City in 1954. Okay. There is the ISBN. And then he gives a statement from their, as I said, Jewish encyclopedia. And the word C-H-A-Z-A-R-S, that was the change of the K sound to the C sound. So Khazars, it still says the same way. And he says, the shoguns of the latter, Emperor Heraclius, Justinian II, after his flight from Kirshan to Doros. So once you go research Kirshan, Doros, Justinian II, it kind of gives more validity to what this man is saying. So right there, he shows a map of Roman Catholics, the Greek Catholics, and the Khazars, a.k.a. the Jews. And it basically is in black and white, so it's very hard to see. But don't worry, there's plenty of other things on YouTube to see this. And then he says the so-called self-styled Jews, which are basically converts that converted to Judaism, Talmudic Judaism, in 7 A.D., and this is the modern septic spelling from their Jewish encyclopedia, okay? And so he says they it reveals the importance of these individuals in the 900s. They're then still known as Khazars prior to the Khazarian kingdom by who? The Russians, as I said earlier in the blog. The Russian people in the 1200s and in the 1000 and to 1200 BC, AD, from 1000 to 1200 AD. So when that all took the case, of course, what ended up happening? Well, we'll talk about that. It's pretty profound. It seems like everywhere they go, there's always clamor, there's always turmoil, there's always death. Not in a straight standpoint of the Old Testament God, where, you know, you look at Deuteronomy chapter 28, verses 1, 15, and it says about all the blessings that will come upon these people if they obey God. But when you look at these people as they move around all around Northern Europe, it didn't seem like blessings came upon them. It seemed more like curses that they benefited from, meaning everyone else did bad and they did good. So question, when you look at Deuteronomy 28 verse 1, you know, it says you be the lender, not the borrower. That's one of the biggest verses that everybody quotes all the time. And these individuals were and are lenders, and they don't borrow. But there's the catch. They lend on both sides of people. They're like bookies, loan sharkies, meaning that they will lend on one country and then on another country and then have those two countries fight, and then they will pick the side that wins, and then they'll jump on that side while the other side is killed and murdered. So no matter what, they win, is my point. There's no way they lose. They always win. Is that the way God operates? No. That is not the way God wants us to operate. So now let's keep going. As I click on the button, come on. Come on, waiting for the... All right, there's not... All right, I got to change it to 2 pages because something ain't right here. Something's not right. I don't know why. Let's see if I can... Move this, make this go bigger. Yeah, there you go. I'm gonna add to that. So that's that page. My little mouse is kind of acting stupid. So there is his dedication. It's pretty powerful. The first section of this is basically a note, a long, deep, philosophical note. Please press pause to read this. This is deep. I'm not going to read it to you. I assume you're intelligent and can read. But I'll take about 5 seconds before I click the next page so you're able to just pause and read and then keep coming. I want to definitely go right here, and I want to highlight something here at 44 minutes and 51 seconds. And that's what I said earlier about the individuals that lived in this particular kingdom of Khazaria. You'll notice that I have highlighted in blue what this is from his own mouth, not mine. This is his own words, not mine. I'm just quoting what he said. You see what it says there in blue? Right below and the bottom of the left column. They were phallic worshipers, which is filthy. He says it's filthy, okay? This is his words, not mine. Filthy. Which I don't want to go into details now, but that was their religion. They were also the religion of many other pagans and barbarians elsewhere in the world. And that's true. They weren't the only ones that were phallic worshipers. A lot of people in the world at that time were. That's why Yah said to the Hebrew Israelites, don't merge with these different tribes. Don't mess with the Canaanites, Jebusites, Malachites, otherites, Philistines, right? Now, but this is a different section of the earth. So the Khazarian king became so disgusted with his kingdom that he decided to adopt a monotheistic faith, and he had three choices. Either Christianity, Islam, or what is known today as Judaism, which, as he says, is really Talmudism. By spitting a top and saying, eeny, meeny, miny, mo, catch a neighbor by his toe. If he hollers, let him go. Eeny, meeny, miny, mo. And mo landed on Judaism. And that became the state religion. So he sent down Talmudic schools. He set them down and the people to these schools. And he brought these rabbis up and opened up synagogues and schools in Khazaria. And then they became what they call Jews. But the reason they became Jews, as his brother said in the video I just did earlier, was not because they wanted to obey God and find the law. They just wanted, I hate to say it, use it as a cover. But then at the same time, if they had a pure heart, and if they were trying to obey what they consider to be God, why is it that everywhere they go, they did such despicable, horrible things to set up certain things to happen in this earth? You would think that the Holy Spirit touched them. But remember, the Holy Spirit had not come into man because it was my people that decided not to accept Christ when he came. And then set up the Edomites, Esau, Edom, a.k.a. Rome, to kill Jesus or Yeshua. But that was the will. That was his purpose. Because his death was allowing his blood to be paid for all the world, even though they may not ever accept him. But he is the atoning sacrifice. Ah. Sorry, my little PC disconnected from this headset. Now, I'm right next to my computer, but unfortunately, the distance between the wireless headset to the wireless dongle, you got to be within 1 foot, it seems like. That's crazy for something $200 and doesn't have good range. It just pisses you off. Anyway, let's go on to the next part. We're not done yet. That is just one of the shocking things that from my research that I had to stop and look at. Okay, and that for this page, and everybody go to the next page. And now we're finishing up. That's just, I think, section one. This is a really tiny book. Now we go to section two. The truth about the Khazars. Now this is another letter written to David Goldstein, who was a LLD, which is, I believe, a lawyer. I think that's the doctorate of letters. And as you see, it says doctor, so it's like a PhD. And he basically has a conversation. I haven't taken time to read this, and I will. But for the video's sake, I'm going to highlight what I'm going to read pretty fast, and then I'm going to highlight what the Holy Spirit lets me see out of the lines of the word. Okay, so that's the first page. Go to the next one. You notice the words are like lots of adverbs, assuredly, lots of adverbs. It's very, like I said, PhD level-esque writing. This section right here, my eyes gravitate to. So I'm going to highlight it. Let's keep going. Next page. This little section right here, I think, is really outstanding. Infiltrations. Oh, it's deep. Look what this thing does. It actually, by accident, I clicked on this. But Kendall did a lookup of the word Jew, and they call it a noun. And look at what they named it. A member of the people and a cultural community whose traditional religion is Judaism, and who traced the origins through the ancient Hebrew people of Israel to Abraham. Well, they trace them, but their trace is BS. They were converted people that took Talmud, and so they can then play on the fact that they trace their religion or origins through the ancient Hebrew people. But the day is coming where the ancient Hebrew people are about to be revealed, not the Judis or so-called Jewish people. That makes sense. Hallelujah. So let me close that. I don't know how I did that, but that was cool. So let's go back to the section right here. As you undoubtedly heard, so here comes that wonderful adverb. The word that slaps me in the face in the middle here is, it says, bringing so-called or self-sized Jews into the Roman Catholic Church as converts. It must recall to you many times the day, so many years ago, when you embraced Catholicism as a convert. So this letter is being written to the guy who wrote this book, who decided to go from Judaism to Catholicism. Problem is, both of them are wrong. Catholicism is ungodly, as well as Judaism. But unfortunately, he was not aware. People at that time believed, like everyone else believes today, that their religion is pure. And until they do the study to show themselves approved and find out the lies as well as the truths, they're able to be able, hallelujah, to get facts and get those answers. But at the same time, we have to be real, and we have to honestly say that the same thing that happened back then happens right now. So right now, this is an argument basically talking about in 1954 that basically, you know, the world is, you know, that these people need help and they need God, and it's like, you know, from a 1954 perspective. At this time, this little section doesn't touch me yet. I haven't found a powerful part of this, but remember, this is one of many, many books. The first section of it was phenomenal. This section, oh, let's go back. This, here comes a good section, and they highlight it right here. And this little section now gets into the question of, what does the word Jewish mean? What does Jewish mean, right? What does Jews mean? And this guy tries to argue that Jesus Christ was Judean and a Judeans, a group of people, and they were not, he was not a so-called European, Khazarian, white, Jewish, mixed breed person that we know of Jewish people to be today. And I agree with that. And this is, he said this in his book in 1945. And he does a lot of times, this last 5, 7, 8 pages is focusing on that, on the breakdown of the word. And so it gets a little bit crazy. For example, talking about how the letters are pronounced. And as he says, I explained the word Jew was a first introduced in 1700s. And so since it was introduced in the 1700s, that wasn't even talked about in the 1600s, 1500s, 1100s, 1200s, 1000, 900, 800, 700 AD. Yeah. And so the last part he breaks down after all this PhD talk. To allege that Jesus was a Jew in a sense during his lifetime, Jesus professed and practiced a form of the religious worship known and practiced under the name, modern name Judaism, is a lie. It's false and fiction and most blasphemous in nature. If it be so, the so-called or self-styled Jew, then or now, the practice of Judaism was a requirement, then Jesus was certainly was not a so-called Jew. Jesus was abhorred by and denounced the form of religious worship practiced in Judea in his lifetime, and which is known and practiced under the new name Judaism. That religious belief was then known as Pharisaism. Pharisaism. Huh. The Christian clergy, that their theological seminary days, but was to have never made an attempt to make that clear to Christians. And that makes a lot of sense, because when you understand why would Yahshua have such a battle in the Gospels with the Pharisees and Sadducees? Because what they were practicing was this Talmud, even back then. And God, through Jesus Christ, hated it. Now, the question I ask myself, and I will continue to, who were in Judea at that time, Jerusalem at that time, Samaria, the period of places that when Jesus walked during that time, were they Europeans? Were they Africans? Were they mixed of both? These are very valid questions. I don't think there were Khazarians that lived north of the Caucasus Mountains. So if you see right here, the original 63 books, check this out, it blows me away. In case you never had the opportunity to investigate the contents of the 63 books, he says, I can help you. So they made a book, it's called the Talmud, and they actually have been writing about this. Problem is that the Talmud, of course, is a mixture of Babylonian, Assyrian, captivity, with so-called things that happen in the history books of the Old Testament. And that's why we got to do a deep, deep dive to break down the truth. We got to do a comparison, a comparison, a comparison, a comparison. Catch those lies. Catch them. And then say, this is a lie. Hallelujah. So now this ends the book. It breaks down Talmud now. He's quoting the Talmud from here on. You see Sanhedrin and all these Talmudic words and, you know, Yebamoth and yeah. This is, again, Talmud. So this part of the end of the book, which blew me away, which slapped me on, and I never, ever, 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 ever heard this. And I definitely want to put this in my notes because this is true. I looked it up online. It is a prayer prayed every year by those that study the Talmud, which to me goes against God and his creative power and being, which makes God unfortunately, a liar. And so for these individual people that serve him, I got to make sure I pronounce this correct. On the next page, you're going to hear about a prayer that when I heard it the first time, I couldn't believe it. It's called the Kol Nidre prayer, the all vows prayer. It really blows me away when you hear this. As you can read that for yourself, I think you understand how horrible this page is. I shouldn't have to read it to you. I expect you to. But I'll paraphrase it because when I read it, I couldn't believe it. God's word is based upon one thing, his vow. God's word, the reason why we believe it today is because when God made a promise or a vow to Abraham, he kept that vow, even if it took 30, 50, 100, whatever number of years. When God made a promise that he would give us a sacrifice for our sins, he kept that vow, taking thousands of years to come to pass, to bring Yahshua on the earth and pay the price for our sin. And today, in 2023, every year, on the Day of Atonement, these so-called self-styled Jews pray a prayer that says that every vow that they made with me, you, anybody, to do certain things, such as business practices, specifically business practices, that they can turn and break that vow. Which blows me away because the scripture that spots me in the face is a scripture that says, I turned some music up. I forgot my music was off. Forgive me. Talking for the last few minutes. Get the music in the background just right as I end this. That Yah is a man that he shall not lie. Neither son of man shall he have to ever repent. So when a person breaks a vow, as you see right here, highlighted in this prayer on the Day of Atonement, all vows, obligations, oaths, anathemas, whether they're called conum, conus, or by any other name, which we may vow or swear or pledge whereby we are bound from this Day of Atonement until the next Day of Atonement, okay, whose happy coming we await, we do repent. Listen to this part. May the deem be absolved, forgiven, annulled, and void, and made of none effect. They shall not bind us, nor have power over us. All vows shall be reckoned vows. All obligations shall not be obligatory, nor the oaths be oaths. Now listen to this. The implications, inferences, innuendos of the Kol Nidre prayer referred to as in the Talmud, in the book of Nedrim, and that's where you can now look for it. And I have the Talmud, 28, 23a through 23b are as follows. And he who desires that none of his vows be made during the year shall be valid. Let him stand at the beginning of the year and declare, Every vow which I make in the full future, in the future, shall be null and void. His vows are invalid, providing he remembers that at the time of that vow. Can you believe that? That a person literally says, before they even go out and do something, it's like me, I'm looking for a beautiful Cisco voice job and saying that I promise to work hard and do a great job, then I get the job and I don't do it. That is ridiculous. I couldn't live my life like that. The greatest study in the Kol Nidre prayer was made by eminent psychoanalyst Professor Theodore Reck, the celebrated pupil of a famous doctor named Sigmund Freud. The analysis of, that's why this is so true, because they're quoting real life people, of the historic religious and psychological background of the Kol Nidre prayer by Professor Reck presents that the Talmud in its true perspective. This important study contained in Professor Reck's The Ritual Psychoanalyst Study and the Talmud on 168 states, the text was to the effect that all oaths which believers have taken between the Day of Atonement to the next Day of Atonement are declared invalid. Before explaining to you how the present wording of the Kol Nidre prayer was introduced in the Day of Atonement synagogue ceremonies, my dear Dr. Goldstein, I would like to quote a passage from the Universal Jewish Encyclopedia. Universal Jewish Encyclopedia confirms that the Kol Nidre prayer has no spiritual value, as might be believed, because it's recited in the synagogues on the Day of Atonement as the prologue of the religious ceremonies which follows it. So you see how they're playing with you? They recite a prologue. They're saying it's a prologue. So it doesn't matter. Well, it's BS. It does matter. Watch this. The secular significance of the Kol Nidre All Vows prayer is indicated forcefully by the analysis of the Jewish Encyclopedia. The Kol Nidre prayer has nothing to do with the actual idea of the Day of Atonement. It attained an extraordinary solemnity and popularity, all these big words, by the reason of the fact that it was the first prayer recited on the holiest of days. Interesting. Why would it be the first prayer you recite on the holiest of days? So now it says, my dear Dr. Goldstein, to prepare for the shock of your life. Okay. And this is yours truly writing to Dr. Goldstein now. He says, prepare for the shock of your life. Ooh, I get the presence of God as I pause there. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Compelled by what you may now read here about the Kol Nidre All Vows prayer, you must be shocked to learn that many Christian churches actually pealed their bells on the Day of Atonement in celebration of that holy day for the so-called self-styled Jews. How stupid can these Christian ministers be? From what I've learned after cursory inquiry, I'm unable to say whether it was a case of stupidity or cupidity. Both. With what you already know together and what you will additionally know before you finish this letter, you'll be able to judge for yourself whether it be stupidity or cupidity. Listen to this. There is not one single fact in the entire letter which every graduate of a theological seminary, which is what I want to be a graduate of. So it's pretty powerful that he puts that in there. Yeah, because that's my ultimate desire. The following news featured in the New World Telegram October 7th, only a few days ago. Under the prominent headline, Jewish Holidays to End at Sundown, the New World Telegram gave prominence to the following story. Synagogues and temples throughout the city were crowded yesterday as a 24-hour fast began. Dr. Norm Salid, head of the Synagogue Council of America, representing three major Jewish bodies, had called on the other faiths, Christian faiths, right, to join the fast. Cutting across religious lines, many Protestant, my churches in the city pealed their bells last night to sound the Kol Nidre traditional melody used to start Yom Kippur. Jesus. The gesture of goodwill was recommended by the Manhattan office of the Protestant Council. That just about tops anything I ever come to my attention revealing the ignorance or the indifference of the Christian clergy to the hazards of facing the Christian faith. From my personal contacts with the Manhattan office of New York and the Protestant Council in the recent past, I hold out very little hope for any constructive contribution that they can make to the defense of the Christian faith against these dedicated enemies. He calls in 1954 that these people are enemies of the Christian faith. Wow. In each instance, they buckled under the pressure exerted upon them by contacts for the so-called self-styled Jews. If it was not so tragic, it would become comical. It was a joke, indeed, but the joke was on the Christian clergy. That's why I said, man, demonic. Demonic. The key word I'm saying? They were not... This is demonic. I hit the wrong button. Go back. Many Christian churches peel their bells. Next page is going to hit you. And the council says the sound of the Kol Nidre prayer, the all vows prayer, the prayer to break vows from last year and future vows, was a traditional melody to start Yom Kippur. Why would it be the traditional melody if this is, as the brother said, worthless, meaningless, don't mean nothing? Exactly. The present wording of the Kol Nidre prayer dates back to the 1000s. A political reversal in Eastern Europe compelled so-called self-styled Jews in Eastern Europe, okay, and of course that'd be Khazaria, that'd be Russia, to adopt the present wording of the Kol Nidre prayer. The story involves the history of the so-called Jew in Eastern Europe. One thing we'll say about them, and they put all this stuff in writing, so if you get a copy of the book, you got them and they're dead in their tracks. Before relating here, brief as possible, the history of the so-called self-styled Jew in Eastern Europe, I'd like to quote another short passage of the Jewish Encyclopedia. In analyzing the course of history which resulted in all in the present wording of the Kol Nidre prayer, it states, an important alteration in the wording of the Kol Nidre prayer was made by Rashi's son-in-law, Merah ben Samuel, who changed the original phrase from the last day of atonement until this one, to this phrase, from the day of atonement until the next. Ooh. From the past to the future. See that? From the past to the present, they start from the present to the future. From the past to the present, he changed the wording from the present to the future. You'll agree to my dear Dr. Goldstein that Merah ben Samuel knew what he was doing. The wording of that altered version of the Kol Nidre prayer makes that the recital of the prayer as a release during the coming year from any obligation to the respect of any oath, vow or pledge made during the coming year. What the hell is this? Literally, it's the hell. Like anyone, your license obtained from a federal, state, or municipal government, the altered version of the Kol Nidre prayer is also a license for 1 year only. The Kol Nidre All Vows prayer extends immunity in advance for 1 year from all obligations to observe the terms of oaths, vows, pledges made in that future year following the Day of Atonement when the prayer was recited. Now, first off, God is not going to answer this prayer. But the question is, would man allow this to happen? Does man allow these so-called Jews to break vows with no judgments. No matter what's in the actual Talmud. But this goes back to 500 AD. Can you believe that? So he spends a lot of time on the Kol Nidre prayer. But I ask about the implications of it. First of all, most, I mean, what's the implications? I mean, literally, okay, they pray that prayer. But it says that they basically they're liars. They're liars, which means I will never trust the so-called self-styled Jew. Fine, I got it. Thank you. I've already felt that from when I met the woman downstairs in my apartment. And that was the Holy Ghost back then, and that's the Holy Ghost now. What blows me away is that, and love this little line here, and it's a lot of long sentence, so hey, as a person that writes long sentences too, he got them as well. My many years of intensive research established beyond the question of any doubt, contrary to the general accepted belief held by many white Christians, that the so-called self-styled Jews in Eastern Europe at any time in their history in the Eastern Europe were never the legendary lost 10 tribes of Bible lore. And there's really 12. That historical fact is uncontrovertible. Who would feel your presence, Lord? They never set a foot in Egypt. What makes this so powerful is that this came out only a couple years after the Jews went in with the help of the United States into Palestine. It was 54 when this book was written. They went in 48. So that's only 6 years later this book was written. That's why he puts in 1948 the Pentagon of Washington addressed a large assembly of the highest United States officers in the military intelligence G2 branch. And what did they know? What did they know? They noted this, which I've been saying already. A highly explosive geopolitical situation in Eastern Europe and in the Middle East. Then, as now, that era of the world was a potential threat to the peace of the world and the security of their nation. Well, I don't know about all that. I explained to them the full origin of the Khazars and the Khazarian kingdom. I felt then, as I feel now, that without clear, comprehensive knowledge of that subject, it's impossible to understand or evaluate properly what's been taking place since 1917. The year of the Bolshevik Revolution in Russia. It is the key to that problem. Thank you, Mr. Friedman. I don't understand why you want to talk about changing the word, the phrase of the Kol Nidre prayer. That is the least of my worries. And you've already broke this down, and this is more information on the Khazars. This little section right here explains who they are. So as you read this and take your time, pause and come back, it breaks down where they were. They basically, you know, invaded Eastern Europe via the land route between the north end of the Caspian Sea and the south end of the Ural Mountains. Okay? And basically, they came from Asia. but then they came into Europe. They're an Asiatic Mongolian nation. They're looked as Turco-Finns racially. They were a warlike nation because all were driven out of the Asian family by the nation of Asia, whom they were continually at war. They invaded Eastern Europe to escape further defeats in Asia. And then that's when they decided to take on Judaism. They were a phallic pagan nation. As it says, their religious worship was a mixture of phallic worship and other forms of idolatry worship practiced in Asia by pagan nations. And that worship continued to the 600s. Their vile forms of sexual excesses indulged by the Khazars as their form of religious worship produced a degree of moral degeneracy that a Khazarian king could not endure anymore. And that's when they decided to choose Judaism. King Bulan was the king's name. And so right here, this page, they don't have a name for the page. But all of this breaks down. He repeats himself a lot. But that's good. Repetition proves, you know, makes it deepens the impression. Great, let's go to the next one. Let's highlight that. Let's go to the next one. It's on the 8th, 9 o'clock. Oh, I love this sentiment. And the knowledge is so powerful. If this is so deep, you can literally do a good class on this stuff. How many pages do I got? He keeps trying to go back to the doggone Kol Nidre prayer. I'm like, dude, come on. There's so many evil things that they've done besides Kol Nidre prayer. Are we getting now to different concepts? Here are some different words. The Zohar, Z-O-H-A-R. Christian idolaters, children of Eve's serpent. Zohar, idolatrous people, Christians, befoul the world. Zohar, souls of Gentiles have unclean divine origins. Rosh Hashanah, non-Jew souls go down to hell. Forbidden to sell religious works to Christians. Beware of Christians walking abroad. Must not associate with Christians. Do not associate with Gentiles. They shed blood. Christians are unclean because they not at Mount Sinai. Proud. This horrible. You see this guy's pulling all this out of the Talmud. Jew must not return greeting a Christian. Do it first. Avoiding with Christians breeds familiarity. It is permitted to deceive Christians. It is permitted to deceive Christians. The name of God is not profane when lying to Christians. It's a bunch of bullshit. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. This is why the Kol Nidre prayer is the least of our concerns. This is what we should be studying. Don't save Christians in danger of death. Don't assist Christians' childbirth on Saturday. If a Jew commits a Christian, kills a Christian, he commits no sin. Wrong. These are not God's chosen. This should be the last page. There it is. And so the rest of this would be connections to the Talmud, sections of the Talmud. But you saw, as I saw, some of the most shocking things that I could not believe when I saw, when I read this. And then now comes this section, which is new to me. I haven't gotten here before. The names of Presidents Woodrow Wilson, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, Harry Truman, Dwight D. Eisenhower, John F. Kennedy, Lyndon Baines Johnson, and our Richard M. Nixon will certainly be found one day inscribed in big red letters in the official annals of the rise and fall of the United States. These seven masks of deception incurred their guilt by debasing the solemn oaths of office on behalf of the undisclosed domestic foreign principals, without any apparent qualms and misgivings to enhance their political fortunes, totally oblivious to the threat to United States security and survival. These seven masters unknowingly, willingly in fact, poison the wells of security for the survival of the United States. Now, he's talking about the U.S., like the U.S. all that. It's much bigger than the U.S. This is Satan versus God, not United States. I don't care about the United States. We care about God. But look at this. Talmudic Jews control news and editorial media, political policies and mass media. I agree with that. That is very true. This is a very true section. Which is why today I don't watch the news. I don't watch CNN. I don't watch anything no more. President Wilson was blackmailed. Justin Brandeis was paid off. Prime Minister of who? George Lloyd was a Zionist tool. Colonel House was an enigma. Talmud Jews select America's ally for the First World War. They did. This would be the Balfour Declaration. Talmud Jews promote Germany's victory, but then tend to stab them in the back. Yes, they did. Because they're always on the side of themselves against everybody else. If the Jewish people say things about Christians, the bottom line is that they had to do us wrong. Why? Because everybody in America is considered to be Christian. Remember, these are Talmud that say all these negative things about Christians. So, of course, they're going to stab us in the back. They're the devil. That's what God calls them, synagogue of Satan. Wow. Wow, Lyndon Johnson mastermind the Six-Day War. Jesus. www.nohoax.com. All right. Let's go look for this website. www.nohoax.com. If it exists. If it still exists, I doubt it. Yeah. They took me over to Cats. Cats taking weed. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's gone now. There was a website, but it's not there anymore. So that was the end of the book. And it covers a lot, my friend. And it is profound. One wonderful time. Tomorrow we'll come back. We'll talk about who is Esau Edom and Brother Weissman and go through his great book and allow that book to open your eyes in Jesus' name. Thank you for watching.